If you've ever experienced a manic episode or a hypomanic episode before, then you know one thing, and that is mania and hypomania can be scary. When we look back on our manic episodes and hypomanic episodes, we realize that we usually did things that we wouldn't normally do when we're not in a mood episode like that. And some of those things can be very destructive towards ourselves and to other people. So as a result, when people come out of manic and hypomanic episodes, they frequently have a fear of becoming manic or hypomanic again in the future. And in this video, I want to talk about how we can approach that fear without letting us destroy us. So first of all, I'm not a licensed counselor, so what I'm about to say should not be taken as medical advice or a substitute for treatment of any kind. However, I do have bipolar type 2, and I've also used to work at a psychiatric hospital with patients who were experiencing manic and hypomanic episodes. So not only have I experienced my own hypomanic episodes, but I've also worked with hundreds of patients who've experienced their own kinds of mood highs in mania and hypomania. So I think I have some good input to share on this topic. And if you want to jump around, there's a bunch of time links in the description to the video. So if you want to jump to a specific portion, jump ahead. So first of all, what is a manic episode or hypomanic episode? In the purest form, a manic episode and a hypomanic episode are essentially a very elevated mood. Elevated does not always mean happy. Sometimes people can be manic or hypomanic and be very irritable and very cranky, very unhappy. So just because someone's manic or hypomanic doesn't mean that they're extremely happy. Although I feel like it does tend to border on the more happy side of the coin. So when someone is manic or hypomanic, they usually experience tons of energy, they don't need as much sleep, they don't eat as much, they get into all these new endeavors, they can sometimes do things that don't show any evidence of planning, such as they have kind of like magical thinking where it's like, oh, I'm just going to become famous by making a YouTube video and everyone's going to love me and I'll be the end of it and I'll be worldwide known. Things like that. So when someone's hypomanic or manic, they can experience a loss of control, which is essentially they lose the control over their judgment and lose control over their actions. They can also do destructive behaviors. Like sometimes people can start to feel like they're essentially invincible and they can put themselves in harm's way. And I've actually almost done that myself when I was in a hypomanic episode as well. And as I talked about earlier, being hypomanic and manic usually portends to being having impaired judgment of some kind. So you make decisions you wouldn't otherwise normally make. And if you want to learn more about mania or hypomania, you can research these things online. There are tons of great resources available online, educational resources. So bearing in mind that manic and hypomanic episodes can be very scary, they can be very destructive. When someone gets out of a manic or hypomanic episode, they can usually then start to have fear of once again becoming manic or hypomanic. And for the record, in terms of diagnosis, someone who has had a manic episode will be characterized as bipolar type 1, and someone who has only had a hypomanic episode will be characterized as bipolar type 2, typically. Hypomanic episodes are essentially low-grade manic episodes, so they're very mood high and you know, impaired judgment, but they don't always derail the person's life in the way that manic episodes usually do. So when people come out of these mood states, they have the fear of becoming manic or hypomanic again in the future because they realize how dangerous it was and how dangerous it could be again in the future. So first of all, why do we fear manic episodes and hypomanic episodes? The reason is simple. We humans are geared towards control. We want to have control over ourselves and our ability to change our future and to control our actions. I mean, if we look at our lives in terms of the evolutionary history of human beings over the last several hundred thousand years, the very reason that our species has survived through so many environmental calamities, through so many eras, through so many different kinds of day-to-day issues, is because we have the ability to control our environment. In essence, if we're cold, we have the ability to find some sort of blanket or some sort of clothing and put it over us and prevent us from getting sick and dying. If we see a predator in the distance, we have the ability to control our ability to run away. So when we humans do not have control, which is something that usually happens during mania and hypomania, it's very scary because losing control is potentially could, you know, ruin our lives or ruin the lives of other people. So that's one of the main reason why people are oftentimes very afraid of becoming manic and hypomanic again. So in that sense, the fear of becoming manic and hypomanic is actually very normal. It makes complete sense because they're not, mania and hypomania, aside from the artificial highs that some people get, like I know I got, they're not positive mood states because of all the other things that go along with it, which are usually bad decisions and impaired judgment. So that's first of all. So that's why we usually become afraid of having manic hypomanic episodes again in the future. So what can sometimes happen as a result of that is people who have bipolar type 1 or type 2 almost prefer to be depressed because they know they're not becoming manic or hypomanic. So let me talk about what I mean by that. One thing that I used to encounter when I work with psychiatric patients in a psychiatric hospital, when I work with people who had bipolar type 1 and 2, is when they were coming down from manic episodes and hypomanic episodes, they basically, they had the fear of becoming manic or hypomanic again in the future, and they essentially voiced the idea that they'd rather just stay depressed going forward than they would ever to risk becoming manic or hypomanic again. So essentially, if they're depressed, they know they're not becoming manic or hypomanic, and that is, to them, a good thing because they're not going into those mood states and losing their control. But the question is that really a good approach to have? Is it productive for us to prefer to be depressed or to be more comfortable with being depressed than to be comfortable with feeling completely stable in terms of our mood? Because there's three different levels here. There's depressed, there's stable, and then there's manic or hypomanic. And just because one thing that happens is when people have manic or hypomanic episodes is when they have a stable mood, they fear that it's eventually going to rise into a manic or hypomanic episode. So they almost do things to push it back down into depression because, again, the depression is predictable. You can control the depression. Like, you know what's going to happen in the depression. Like, you're going to be unhappy, you're going to be sad, but you won't most likely do things that are really bizarre and that could ruin your life or ruin the lives of others. Obviously, when you're depressed, you could harm yourself and that's not good. But if you've been through depressive episodes before in the past and you don't have a history of harming yourself, then it's more safe on the surface level, in the superficial sense, to be depressed than it is to be manic or hypomanic, because if you become manic or hypomanic, then you could do something that completely destroys your life or destroys the life of someone else. So that's the one thing I've consistently come across, also not only working in the psychiatric hospital, but also when I do work. I do some posting on a couple forums online that are geared towards people who have bipolar type 1 and type 2, and I see that common refrain, which is, I'm depressed, and it's like, I'd rather be depressed because I know that I'm not becoming manic or hypomanic. So that's one thing that happens. Another thing that happens, and this is also very destructive in terms of someone's happiness and productivity, is that when someone feels stable, again, they're not depressed, they're not manic, they're not hypomanic, when someone feels stable, it scares them. When someone feels stable, they start to have fear that they're on the upswing to become manic and hypomanic in the future. So it's almost like if you have bipolar type 1 or type 2, you feel inclined to never be happy, because if you're happy, it's like, well, I was happy early on before I went to my manic or hypomanic episode, so therefore if I'm happy again in the future, it must be because I'm definitely going into a manic or hypomanic episode. So you can see how it's like once you have the manic or hypomanic episode, feeling comfortable, feeling stable, and feeling happy is almost scary. It's almost like, well, that's going to eventually, slippery slope, lead me into the mood state that I don't want to be in, which is the mania, hypomania. And these things can take away people's happiness once they've been diagnosed as bipolar type 1 or type 2. It's not uncommon that people, essentially, in addition to, the stigma of having a mental illness, the realization that you have a mental illness, those two things, then there's a third thing of like, well, what if it gets worse? What if I go through something in the future that's, what I went through in the past? So you have all these different levels of things that you fear when you get diagnosed. And this fear of mania or hypomania is a very, very big one, because it's almost like someone with bipolar type 1 or type 2 will do anything to prevent themselves from becoming manic or hypomanic again in the future. And the point I'm trying to make in making this video is the one I'm going to talk about here in a couple minutes is that while we want to be mindful of the possibility of becoming manic and hypomanic, we don't want to be so afraid of it that we're never allowed to be happy, that we always force ourselves to be depressed because then we know what we're getting into. Okay, so let's talk about what we can do to sort of prevent us from being always stuck on depressed when we have bipolar type 1 or type 2. First of all, the one thing we need to do, first and foremost, is we need to be mindful of our mood states. So when we look back on our manic and hypomanic episodes, we need to find the key factors, the key triggers that led into that mood state, because usually there are some warning signs early on. For example, you might start to feel like you don't need as much sleep. You might start to feel like you don't need to eat as much. You might start to be happy and really happy for no reason whatsoever. Like, nothing happens in your life that was positive, but all of a sudden you're just really happy. There could be a seasonal pattern to your moods. I know for me, I have a spring, summer kind of seasonal issue. At least I've, you know, historically had this before I've been diagnosed and started on medication, which have been working very well. But I had this constant pattern where once like April came around, my mood would just go way up because the sun would come out, the weather would be nice. And then in the fall, when it started to get darker and it started to be colder and I had to stay inside more often, I would get much more irritable, cranky for no reason. So we need to find the triggers or the patterns, the indicators that we might be going into a manic or hypomanic episode. And we need to make note of those things. So whatever, you know, came before our manic and hypomanic episodes in the past could very well be the things that come before the next manic or hypomanic episode we experience if we are going to experience one in the future. So we need to be mindful of those things. We need to always be looking out for those things in a very objective way. We don't want to be constantly searching and constantly afraid that anything that happens could be, you know, the future going into a hypomanic episode or a manic episode. But we just want to be mindful in a very objective sense of like, okay, how am I feeling? You know, am I doing anything that was similar to what I was doing before I was manic or hypomanic? That sort of thing. That we want to be very objective, almost like we're sort of like watching a movie and we're just sort of objectively watching the movie, like what is going on in the movie? What is being experienced in the screen? That sort of thing. So know our triggers and warning signs. We want to make adjustments when necessary. So if we're starting to feel abnormally happy for no reason, we want to make adjustments. We want to talk to our prescribing doctors or our therapists or our counselors about those things and get their input about it. If we're starting to feel depressed for no reason, same thing. We want to start to figure out, you know, why are we going into this negative mood state? What change do I need to make? You know, we human beings, we tend to change moods over time in very sort of gradual ways based on what we're experiencing in our lives. So if you lose your job and you become unhappy because of it, yeah, it's normal for you to become unhappy because you lost your job. Or if you get into a new relationship and you're really excited about the relationship, it's normal to feel happier when that's going on. But if you're looking at your life and you're becoming happier or depressed and there's really no reason to explain why that might be, like you're not working on, you know, improving yourself or you're not, you know, letting yourself go and becoming, miserable and unhappy, then you need to start to figure out, well, like what adjustments might I need to make? Like what's going on here that need to sort of balance things out to stability? Because we really want to stay at the stable level. So next thing, and this is really important, keep your friends and your family and your social circle apprised of what you do when you become manic or hypomanic, what signs they should look for, and like, you know, where you seek treatment at and all sorts of things like that. So essentially this. If mania and hypomania is essentially a loss of control, then we want to have some sort of barrier around us to where people can act on our behalf when we can't act on our own behalf. So if you're becoming manic, and in the process of becoming manic, you stop taking your meds, and you don't listen to anybody, and you think everything's fine, and you come up with all these new ideas of things you want to do, and nothing makes sense, then you want to, because you can't control your actions during that time, or at least you have less control of your actions during that time, you want to have people around you who know what to look for when you become manic so that they can act on your behalf if necessary. So for example, for me, when I got diagnosed a few months ago with bipolar type 2, what I did was I sent my family and my friends a list of things of saying, hey, look, when I become hypomanic, this is what I do, and this is what I do before I become hypomanic, and this is when I usually become hypomanic, at least historically. Hopefully it won't happen in the future. And I said, like, you know, here's what I'm being, the medication I'm taking, here's the doctor I'm working with, here's the phone numbers of for my family. I gave my friends phone numbers, for my friends I gave my family phone numbers. So I basically said, look, you know, if these things start to happen and I start to be essentially unreachable where I'm not listening and I'm going off the deep end, then, you know, you have some steps you can take to help me. Now, obviously we don't want to make our health the responsibility of other people, but if the fact comes down to it where we enter a mood state where we fundamentally do not have the ability to reason or think critically, then we need to have a backup plan just in case that ever happens. Because when it comes down to it, people who have bipolar type 1 and bipolar type 2, even if they're on medications and even if that medication is very stable, they still have the possibility of becoming manic or hypomanic in the future. It's just unfortunately the way the world works. Does it mean it will absolutely happen? No. But it means that it very well could happen. So if the manic and hypomanic episodes are based around our ability to care for ourselves, then we need to have some sort of backup plan in place for if that ever happens, despite our best intentions, despite our treatment, despite our taking medications, despite our taking all precautions for our health. If things go off the rails, we need to have people around us who can help us when that happens. So that's very important. So have your action plan when you discuss with your friends and your family that of things they can do And just say, just write down, say, look, if I reach the point where I say, I'm having these hardcore delusions and you can't talk to me, you can't reason with me, you know, here's the hospital I go to, here's the doctor I go to, you know, talk to them. And another thing too is, when you work with your mental health professionals, whether they be therapists, counselors, psychiatrists, psychologists, whatever it might be, make sure that you sign the legal documentation that allows your family to be knowledgeable about your care, so that when the time does come, if it does happen, if it unfortunately does happen, where you are hypomanic or manic and you need someone to act on your behalf, they have the ability to do that. So for example, if you have, let's say, family that lives in town, and you have some friends that are, you know, some close friends, and you want them to be involved in your care, then you want to make sure that you include them on the privacy form so that when they call your doctor, the doctor can legally talk to them. Because if you don't sign those forms and write their names on them, that as a person they can contact, then when your friend calls and says, hey, you know, my buddy is manic and he told me what to do when he becomes manic, the doctor can't talk to you, talk to that person about your treatment because you didn't sign the form with that person's name on it. So make sure you do the privacy forms. It's part of the HIPAA, the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. It's really important legislation that is meant to protect everybody, but in times when you can't act on your own behalf, it can be a hurdle or a detriment to actually having other people help you. So make sure you sign those papers. So that pretty much covers it, but I want to end on a little bit of a motivational note. So if you have bipolar type 1 or type 2, you're allowed to be happy. I mean, being happy, being content is a good thing. It's part of being human. It's a condition that we should strive to be in. Just because our manic and hypomanic episodes are an extreme version of happiness doesn't mean that anytime we're happy, we're automatically becoming manic or hypomanic. That's not how it works. Obviously, there are, if you know, there are certain signs for you that, you know, your mood starts to go up without reason and you start to, you know, not sleep as much, not eat as much, then that's one thing. But if you're simply being content because your treatment's working, because you're taking steps to care for yourself, then that's a good thing. Be content with it. Do not fear mania and hypomania. Respect it, but do not fear it. So think of your mania and hypomania as a dog in the corner of the room that you don't know whether the dog is friendly or you don't know whether the dog is mean. So what you want to do is simply respect the dog. Respect that it's there. Be like, I see you. I know you're there. I'm not going to do anything to provoke you, but I'm not going to sit here and be afraid you're going to come attack me all the time. I'm taking whatever steps I need to be safe. You're over there. You know, if you start to approach me, I will take the proper actions, but if you stay over there, hey, that's fine. So when we have that dog in the corner that we don't know its disposition, we don't want to go in front of its face and start waving our hands and you know, trying to freak it out, because it's going to make it more likely it's going to attack us. In much the same way, if we have bipolar type 1 or type 2, we don't want to let our health go by the wayside, because that's essentially putting us at greater risk to have mania or hypomania. So make sure you get enough sleep. 7 or 8 hours a night. Make sure you eat a good diet. Make sure you keep in touch with your moods. Make sure you do coping skills like meditation or you know, positive self-talk, things like that. Make sure you get time to yourself every day, or at least a few hours a week that you can de-stress and be happy. Don't overload yourself with too many stimuli, with too much noise, too much action, too much physical or mental stress. Don't do those things, because those things that will, you know, potentially push you towards a negative state of mind. But at the same time, allow yourself to be happy. It's okay to be happy. It's good to be happy. And that's really my motivation for everyone out there. As I said, I used to work at the psychiatric hospital, and I came across a lot of people who essentially, once they were diagnosed as bipolar, they just said, like, well, I can't be happy again, because it's like I might become manic or hypomanic. It's like, no, you can be happy. But you shouldn't want to be manic or hypomanic, but you can be happy. And being happy is a good thing. Being content with life is a good thing. So we should all strive to do that. We should not allow this diagnosis to make us more depressed, because that's not going to help anything. You know, in Buddhism, there's an old saying that when you get an injury, you feel pain twice. The first pain is the pain of the injury itself. For example, if you tear your ACL, you feel the pain of the torn ACL. The second pain is the suffering you experience at the recognition that you have pain. So in other words, if you're a football player and you tear your ACL, you feel the pain of the ACL tear, but then you also feel the suffering that you experience when you realize you might never be able to play football again. And the thing is, we can control that second fear, that second pain. We can control that. So we don't want to add pain and depression on top of our problems that already exist. So that's my motivation for everybody. Hopefully this helps you. If you have any comments, you want to share a story, leave a comment in the discussion board below, and have a great day.